I'm absolutely soaked. It's typical Cornish weather out there, unfortunately, today, tipping it down with rain. Sorry it's taken a day to get this video online. I wasn't able to cut it together yesterday because I was working. The whole meeting is posted here, so you can check it out if you weren't able to make the meeting. So, Thursday's meeting. A bit disappointing for me. We had 18 people turn up, which is really great. I know that there's a huge number of people that have that expressed their interest but were unable to make it on the night. So this video is for you to let you know what's going on and everything. Out of those 18, 16 people voted to protest the closure of the current post office as a Crown post office via petitions or some such mechanism. Unfortunately, when asked if there were any volunteers to organise and help do that, nobody came forward. So we're still looking for volunteers to help with that protest action. If you're interested in volunteering, please let me know at this URL here and we'll be in touch and give you all the details, all the information we know, and we'll try and get started on that campaign. So the second bid was, do we as a community come together, form a cooperative in order to run the post office as a franchise ourselves? It was about, do we express our interest to do that? Unfortunately, out of the 18 people, only two people voted for that. So currently, as it stands, that's not going to happen. Obviously, there's still the opportunity to please vote here and to please tell us if you want to be a volunteer to help protest the post office closure, maybe organise a petition or something like that. For the benefit of everybody that wasn't able to make the meeting, the meeting's at the end of this video, so please, if you've got the time, do have a listen. Do listen to the points that were put forward. Obviously the vote's still open. We've got until the 8th of February to express our interest about the cooperative. It's now the 4th, so we've got 4 days. You can vote at this URL here. Obviously we need quite a few people to vote for it to become a majority. So at the moment, it's probably not going to happen. Obviously, we desperately need volunteers in order to organise any protest action. So please, if you're interested in volunteering to help fight the post office closure, do get in touch with us. It was Chris from the Communication Workers Union who attended the meeting. Unfortunately, I've just had the day after the meeting some information from Tony from the Communication Workers Union. He contacted me the day after the meeting to see how the meeting had gone. Tony's opinion is that we've fought a lot of these battles before. He's seen huge petitions come together with a lot of signatures on them and they've not unfortunately changed the post office's mind or changed anything. It's a shame that Tony wasn't able to make it to the meeting because he was travelling abroad, and that he wasn't able to get us this information sooner, but it's new information, so I thought I'd add it to this video. Check out the meeting, let me know your thoughts. Most importantly, let me know your votes, and also let me know if you're interested in organising any protest action against the post office closures at the above URLs, and the URLs are down in the notes as well, so let me know.
Should we get going? I think so. Thank you everybody for coming. Obviously you wouldn't be here if you were concerned about the closure of the post office. So thank you all for turning out on such a horrible evening. Now I've used this title, which is very provocative for the invite, Facebook invite. That's mostly because this one didn't fit. But essentially that's what we're discussing today, to ensure Redruth retains suitable facilities after the post office franchises its local branch. So what they're trying to do is get find an existing retailer and put a post office inside an existing retailer's branch. Now there aren't many large retailers in Redruth. There isn't a WH Smith's, there isn't a large co-op. So they've not had very much luck so far. I'm Rob, by the way. Hello, everybody. Probably seen my post about this on Facebook or somewhere. I'm Rob with Hair, on any platform if you want to find me or talk to me later on. Easy to remember, that's why I use it. I'm concerned sitting, I put that patron of lost causes. Now I put that because I spent many years working in the music industry and then opened a craft shop, and if you can get that to work, then you know I'm quite used to trying to make things work. So let me tell you about what we know. We don't know very much. The information's been very, very thin on the ground, but I have been able to get in touch with a couple of people that have given me some tips. Hi, come in. So the post office wants to close Redruth's current branch. It's a Crown post office, so it's owned by the post office. There aren't actually many of these left in the country that are owned by the post office. Most of them are inside other shops and things like that. And we're very lucky to have one in Redruth, but we're not going to have that moving forward. It's very much the model that the post office is moving towards. They're not going. They've very much made up their mind this is how it's going to work. None of the standard post office partners or large retailers have come forward, such as Wilkinson's. I've spoken about that. We don't have a large Co-op or WH Smith's in town. We know one retailer has come forward. I know who they are, but they've asked me not to say who they are. So we know that they've come forward and commenced talks with the post office. They're very interested in the possibility of the increased footfall and increased profit to their business. I'll show you approximately where they are later on. I've managed to get through. The post office has told their staff that they're not allowed to talk to anybody. And there's been some issues in the past where people have been disciplined for talking to people. So I have tried to get in touch with people, and I've spoken to the union, the Communication Workers Union. I don't suppose anyone's... Hello, thank you so much for coming. Yes, I'm sorry I did badger you to come along today, but I think, we could turn this into a great opportunity. So sorry, what's your name again?
Chris
Welsh. Chris, so you're going to be representing, really, the workers at the post office, and so giving their point of view. And I've managed to talk to Post Office Public Relations. The area manager wouldn't even talk to me. But he did put me in touch with a PR person who did talk to me about it. So I've got a bit of information, but not very much. What I have heard is there's very little chance the Post Office will change their mind about the location I've got. I don't know if you've got anything to add onto that, or what you've been told about that at all, but from what I've been told from the is basically that this is what's going to happen. It's all about can we find the right place for it to go, and we've got a very short timeline. We didn't even have enough time for us to have a Chamber of Commerce meeting in the beginning. So originally we were going to have an earlier meeting on Tuesday, but it seemed to make little sense. There wasn't enough time, so we've ended up putting this emergency meeting after the Chamber of Commerce meeting, because we've got very little time to express our interest if it is something that we want to look after. This is where the current retailer is on the street, the little dot there. They're on 4th Street. They've got a reasonably sized shop, they're quite excited about the increased footfall. Going into their shop, that I know that there's only been one retailer that's expressed an interest, and that was from yesterday. So as far as we know, this is their only option. I also know that they're currently on the list of retailers that the post office doesn't work with. It has a list of an excluded list.
My name is Shishikins.
It has an excluded list of retailers that it's not allowed to work with usually, and because there's only been one person that's come forward, they're making an exception. They're trying to work it out, basically, which is a little worrying, but that's what they're working on at the moment. So obviously, outcomes. What's the best outcome? I think. I'm assuming, anyway, that all of us would prefer it to stay where it is in its current building. Is that kind of just gauging the room? What do people think?
Not particularly.
Not particularly.
The service being.
Exactly. I think that's the key, and I think that it's got a building at the moment with plenty of room to queue indoors. It's got, you know, a lot of windows. Yeah.
Well, contrary view, I think it would be preferential to keep it in its current building.
Yeah.
Because if you divorce the two, then you put the sorting office immediately at risk.
Do we know what's happening to the sorting office? Is that staying?
I have got a bit of information about that. I think, heard a bit of information from a member of staff that says that the sorting office may not be staying. According to the post office, a PR person that I spoke to, they've not heard that the sorting office is moving locations. They are completely different, obviously, Royal Mail and the post office, and they've not heard anything about the sorting office move. I'm again reading between the lines here because nobody will give me any information to go on, but I'm working kind of on the assumption at the moment from what he said that the Royal Mail own the building there or the land. And one of the reasons why they may be trying to relocate, and again it's only an assumption, is because of the amount of lease that they're paying in lease.
Okay. Just add 2 pence worth here. It used to be an ex-Royal Mail employee manager. And I know from the modelling in Kent, what they were trying to do when this sort of thing happened was to relocate the sorting office because the volume of packets, etc., is built up, and they would not normally be looking for a bigger premises.
Yeah.
So it's an ideal opportunity, and of course not only that, but Royal Mail makes use of the building. Mm. And that's another concern, because we can end up with another building on the high street with no occupancy.
Exactly, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. It could be like you say there, that's what's going on. But from reading between the lines, it seems that Royal Mail own the building, and you know, from being a leaseholder of a commercial premises myself, I know that rents increase over the years. And however, there's plenty of commercial property in Redruth that's very cheap.
That's it. One, I couldn't care less whether the sorting's done, except that I like to see employment remaining in Redruth. But where the sorting is done, it'll end up at Poole, I expect, somewhere. Is of no interest to me. Yeah. We get an appalling service from both the Royal Mail and the Post Office. We get an appalling service from both of them. The sooner they're both wound up, the better, but at the moment there's nobody else to do the job. But it seems to me a big disincentive, which may help protect it, is how will they sell that land? I mean, who else is going to want that site? We've got empty sites in the town now, and I can't see a buyer for that site myself. And that will be a disincentive for them, because they won't be realising any capital.
Let's move forward from this, because it actually doesn't make very much difference what they're doing. We've got to work on what we do know, and we don't have anything to do with the Royal Mail side of things anyway, so if we just move on.
Sorry, Mary.
I would just say it's hardly a listed building. The front is, anyway.
Yeah.
And my gut feeling is that it's too valuable for them to just let a new incomer stay in the same place, because they could develop it or sell it to a developer for we don't know what.
Very possible.
And I have no concerns where it is, as long as it's accessible.
Yeah. We're not short of commercial premises in Redruth, although there's some shortage of very large commercial premises, but there's plenty of shops which unfortunately are closed at the moment.
I did email a long... Did you see it? Because I wasn't sure.
I've read it.
Because I'm pleased to see Ross is here, because I thought somewhere down in the new Beyond Market Way would be potentially helpful if we were going to do it as a cooperative.
Very possibly. So obviously, best case scenario, potentially, obviously some people don't care that much anyway, that it stays in its current building. Now, the reason I've put that there is because the facilities, there's quite a lot of windows. It can grow up and down to depending on how big the queue is. If it ends up being one booth in the back of a shop, then obviously, it can't really scale to reach demand, and there won't be very much room for people to queue. The second best thing would be if it has similar kind of facilities but in a different building, because obviously then you've still got the number of booths and you've still got the queuing space. this is what they're aiming for, which is a counter in the or counters in the back of an existing retailer. However, they have said if they can't do that, they will probably try and put multiple franchises into multiple small retailers.
What does that mean?
So in other words, if we've got two corner shops that are like, yeah, we'll have a booth in the back, they'll put two different booths in two little corner shops, so you'll end up with two post offices instead of one, you know, maybe on the same street even. Seems a bit odd, but they're obviously desperate to do it. And obviously, the one at the bottom, which is probably not going to happen, is that we lose all facilities, because it's not in the interest of the post office to lose that income stream either. So they're going to try to, you know, do something other than that, I think. So there are a few different ways, and please, if anyone's got any suggestions of ways that we can safeguard it, we could contact, protest and petition the post office to keep it where it is and not change anything. I think that would be a waste of time. It's been done. Other communities have desperately tried to keep their post office. And if they've made their decision about what's going to happen, then that may, you know, it's definitely worth a shot. It's worth a shot, but I don't think that it's going to happen personally. There's what I'm trying to suggest here is that we offer a solution to the problem, and we'll talk about that in a bit. Of course, we could. There are plenty of people who will say, I don't need a post office. Who cares about the post office? What's the point, you know? I think that's very inward-looking, you know, about their particular personal circumstances, but also there's a lot of things that the post office does for the town in terms of people coming to the town. In Redruth, we're losing HSBC Bank. There are going to be increased short-term 1 to 2 hour parking charges, and there is going to be a flat evening parking charge put on the car parks by Cornwall Council, because they're not very forward-looking either. And so we've got a real risk of people running out of reasons to come to Redruth when they can go to a shopping centre and shop for free and do their, you know, whatever they need to there. So for you know, Chamber of Commerce, for business owners, this is kind of like a, you know, something that we could seek to protect, really. So I've put Albert Einstein maybe, because it's some people aren't sure. If we just do exactly the same thing, if we keep the post office where it is in the same building with the same business model, the same everything, then I've no doubt that it will fail. It's obviously not working for the post office at the moment. If they were making a packet of money from it in its current state, and do interject if you think I'm wrong, either of you guys on the corner there, then they probably wouldn't be doing this, because it's no doubt expensive to them as well. So I don't necessarily think, personally, my personal opinion, that doing exactly the same thing is gonna yield different results. But, you know, we could turn this into an opportunity. I think that, you know, probably everyone around this table could come up with their own kind of list of things that they think that the post office has missed or could do differently, or you know perhaps a service that they could offer that they've not been offering or something. One option, and this is one option, and people should, you know, pitch in if they've got other ideas. We can offer a bid for the franchise ourselves, secure the kind of post office that we want. Obviously, we, as the community, have a collective intelligence about Redruth. We know Redruth a lot better than the distant large post office, and we could provide a service for the people of Redruth that could do a lot better. This is something that I ask myself a lot. Although I've recently only just moved to Cornwall, it's what would Poldark do? And I think we need to think about our heritage here in terms of, we are a mining area, but we're an area of great industry. And sometimes when there are big problems like this, one of the ways that they were solved is the way that they created the mines that are all around us is coming together to form groups, companies, in order to solve big problems. And maybe this is something that we could do to create the kind of post office that we'd like to see in our community. So this kind of an open bit here, if anyone would like to suggest any things that they would like to see from a post office in Redruth. I've put a list there myself of kind of things. I think that if it ended up being in the back of an existing retailer's shop, I don't think that they would put in the same number of counters that there are at the current post office. I may be wrong. Yeah.
Just to give you some information, my understanding is that they're looking to put two counters.
Two counters. So that would be a reduction from six. Is it six in the current post office down to two?
Yeah, there's very rarely six open.
No, there's only ever three.
Three is usually what's open, but two is what I've been told.
So that young man has to say.
You ready for me? Okay, I represent workers that work for post offices. I don't represent members in Royal Mail, but obviously my colleagues in Royal Mail and I converse greatly. We had 1,580 Crown post offices and I've, back in 1988, and that's been whittled down to less than 300 now, and they've come after them one by one. Now, it has to be said, in recent years, fewer and fewer businesses have come forward to take over a Crown post office because it's not a viable option for them. WH Smith's is obviously the big retailer that has done partnerships with the post office, and Penzance and St. Austell are two cases in point. I am here to defend jobs, you know, not necessarily the members, because actually I was in the post office all afternoon this afternoon talking to the members in there, and it has to be said, if there's a package on the table, there's some of them will take it. But they also understand my position, that I am here to defend well-paid, well-trained, dedicated jobs. The difference between a Crown and any other kind of post office is just that. You get dedicated staff, conscientious staff. Whatever you might think of the service, it's not the fault of the staff. They are extremely well-trained. When you lose a Crown post office, it has a significant effect on the entire high street and the community. Because it becomes a franchised office in the main, immediately they expect up to 30 to 40% less people to use that post office overnight. So immediately they put, that's why they can put just two counters in, because they know that as soon as they move it from A to B, they are wiping out 30 to 40% of customers who just won't use it. But that's not just customers that won't use the post office, that's customers that won't use the high street. They won't even come into town. They will do all their shopping other areas. And let's face it, Redruth High Street hasn't got a great deal to offer. So the businesses that there are really need that post office to help the other businesses survive. I am only interested in retaining the status of the post office, the Crown post office. I appreciate what you're trying to do here tonight, and I have to say that if a post office was to be franchised, the model that is being proposed sounds like a more ethical model than the kind that you normally get, which is we don't really care about the post office, we don't care about the post office service you get, we only care about dragging your feet in our door to buy everything else that we've got in that shop. However, the proposal is still a franchise, and as a union, we are opposed to that. We are about protecting the network, such as exists at the moment. The post office is struggling badly to actually get rid of post offices, because the post office proposition is that they are hard work, you know, and they are not paying. More and more post offices, particularly in rural areas, are going into places like garages, you know, and they're losing your community post office or your sub-post office and going into these kind of businesses. And you do wonder where on earth the post office is going next. It doesn't seem to have any idea what it is anymore. And it seems that it's managed decline. But the Crown Post Office still provides. And that's what I'm here for, and I'm sorry to say it, but I'm up for plan A, which is we do resist, we do petition, we do demonstrate, we do all those things to try and retain the status as a Crown.
Does
we have successes, work? Yes, we have had successes. If it's W.H. Smith's, we have no success, because they are hard-nosed enough to say, we don't care. And we don't actually care if only half the people use the post office. It's still going to help our business. But an independent retailer are far more sensitive to the community than a big player like W.H. Smith's. The co-ops and the Wilkinsons have backed off from post offices entirely, not interested anymore. They do have a number around the country, but they are realising that actually it costs them more to have a post office. They would rather have that space and then tins of beans in that place where the post office is. W.H. Smith's, on the other hand, is one of the few retailers that feel it is worth their while. But independent retailers are very sensitive to the campaigns and the belief that people will not use the post office and will not use their business if they proceed with the franchise. And I have to say, that's where I'm at.
I completely agree with you. I think that what we're trying to do here is formulate a plan B. If nothing changes, I think everyone's happy. We can still use the facilities. We're formulating a plan B for if things have to change, which is the message that I've got from the post office. And protecting those jobs would be first and foremost. Obviously, depending on the members' opinions, but in that plan.
Three things. I was interested when you said that when it changes from Crown to franchise, 30 or 40% immediately walks away. Why is that?
Because the public know exactly what it's about. Penzance is again case in point. We have what's called hosted branches, so they retain the status of Crown and they actually go into a W.H. Smith's. Bit complicated. Truro is going to be one of those in the next few months. And the post office actually plan, so they put less hours into the new office than the old office because they know automatically you lose traffic.
If you've only got a tiny little site.
People understand what it is they're getting.
What are you getting differently if I go into one of these franchises?
Typically, I mean, let's talk about space. We mentioned earlier, you've got a post office which is crammed at the back of the shop. So you've got a check through, your push chairs, your buggy, wheelchairs.
So access,
but not just for those people, but also ordinary people who have to walk down aisles to get to the post office. Then when they got there, it's a very small area and you can't even queue there. Right? So, or the queue's going all the way back through all the shelves and people know exactly what it is. And there is, believe it or not, a loyalty to the post office, but it's got to be a real post office. There is less loyalty to a sub-post office and far less loyalty to a franchise because they understand, people do understand exactly what it is. It's a secondary business that's propping up their primary business. And that's not what people want.
I mean, you might not even know that it's there. If you're walking past and there's a small little sign in the corner, you know. Was there a hand up over here?
No.
Someone have... No?
Sorry,
Sinead. Yeah, you...
I was going to ask, so what's the probability that if it doesn't go to a franchise that they just go, well, there's a post office in the co-op by the old fire station, which has shut down. There's a post office in the back of this one. We'll just close it anyway.
Depends on the locality, but they are politically sensitive, I have to say, the post office are. Incidentally, you spoke about a retailer that came forward that's not on their list.
Yes.
To be fair to the post office, and the novel ways, But to be fair to them, they are very sensitive again about the kind of partner that they have. And so if the partner is not appropriate to the post office, then they won't entertain it.
The kind of services they're concerned about are payday loan services. It surprised me because I'd spoken to, I think it was you I spoke to last time, I spoke to you on the phone and you were like, they are very sensitive about it. Then talking to the chap from the post office PR, they said, well, we've not done it before, but we're seriously considering it because they've scaled down their payday loan services. So, you know, I don't think we can rule it out.
There's
good on them for stepping in as well, because if nobody steps in, then it may close. You never know.
There is also a conflict of interest. So if the business might have certain products or services which the post office offer, and so there's a clear conflict of interest there. But at the moment, sorry, what's the question you asked?
I said, what's the possibility, because there are little sub-post offices in backs of shops already in Redruth, what's the possibility that they just say, we'll shut it because they can go to...
Well, there has to be an offering. There has to be an offering which they are regulated by what they deliver and by the population and how far these other post offices are. Now, the fact that Redruth is there suggests that they would have to, and the fact they are searching for a franchise partner suggests that they would have to have a presence in the home.
Can we take one more question and then move on?
Do you know what the relative footfall is, Redruth, to other towns that may or may not have been successful in retaining their post offices? You know, what the turnover is, so that they, I mean, if you were going to fight to retain it, but actually it was one of the worst performing financially for the post office, that presumably would diminish the chances of a total retention anyway.
Early last year they announced 20 crowns to go, and these were crowns that were making a big loss. And then they announced a further 20, and these were not necessarily making a loss, but they expected them to make a loss in the coming years. They've now announced just 37 nationally, and these are offices we think they just want to offload, just get off the books. And incidentally, the post office will carry a loss-making office. For example, Trafalgar Square probably costs us, as a post office, £1 million a year in subsidy. But they aren't going to close Trafalgar Square, not ever. That is always going to be there. So Little Red Ruth, you know, if they're not making a profit, the amount that they are losing is going to be far less significant than Trafalgar Square.
And would they be looking at the profit based on things that can only be transacted through a post office and the other retail offering? Because if they're taking away the other retail offering, is the post office even viable?
There isn't really a retail offering in the current post office. It's mostly like bits of cardboard and
packaging for parcels and
which
obviously
not good for the environment either.
That's irrelevant. So we'll move on for that from the time being. So what the post office are, I think, are mostly concerned about is transferring their risk onto another business. You mentioned about loss making post offices and things like that, but if they put it inside another retailer, then that retailer has to make money, and it's much less risk for them. They do want to continue to provide adequate services in Redruth. They've said this to me. It would be silly for them to just stop providing services in Redruth, because obviously they make profit from that. So it would be counterproductive for them to just completely close Redruth post offices, but like it has been mentioned, there is one up in the Co-op, and there will presumably be some sort of franchise in Camborne, so they may decide that that they can do it. We don't know, because they're giving us it's a complete blackout pretty much on details at this stage. So they do want a high quality retailer promoting their services in Redruth. If we were to put together a proposal for a franchise as a community, obviously there are several different ways it could go.
an individual could put that forward, or a company could put that forward, or there are other structures such as cooperatives. If an individual, if one of us suddenly decided we cared so much about it that we then went out there and bid for the franchise ourselves, that would be very high risk, difficult to finance, being an individual on your own. Obviously, it would be a huge commitment because they'd have to run that post office. And the individual would profit, they'd have a high risk of failure, and it would end up being owned by the individual. This is a bit easier for a company, because risk is shared. It's easier to finance as a group. There's a smaller commitment from as a company. The shareholders end up taking the profit from that, but there is a lower risk of failure because there's more capital available for companies and it's owned by its shareholders. What I'm suggesting today is that if we were to form a community cooperative, the risk is shared, it's easier to finance, there's a shared commitment from all of us, from the whole community involved in the project. The community profits, sorry, I put CIC under company, you know, we can definitely talk about CIC in a sec, because the wealth remains in Redruth, which is really important. It's got the lowest risk of failure. The failure rates for companies are 30% in the first year, 50% over 5 years, and only a third make it to 10 years. I've been talking to the Plunkett Foundation very recently about this potential project, and they've got a 95% of their community shops that they've opened are still open, which is really good, still trading. So that's their 95% success rate. It ends up being owned by the community and run by the community, which gives the community a reason to use, like you were just saying. It would benefit the post office workers because you'd have people footfall through the shop because the community would want to use the shop if they owned it. It trades primarily for the benefit of the community. It's one member, one vote, not one share, one vote. So it doesn't matter how many shares you would buy in a community cooperative. You have one vote, and that does give you actually an advantage in terms of the intelligence of the group being able to make decisions. Primarily, trading purpose is to provide benefits for the community. It does pay members dividends. That's a variable amount, but there is a limit to how much dividends could be paid out to people that buy community shares. And profits have to be reinvested into the community in some way. So it's not that kind of co-op. What do I mean by the horse there? So you're probably used to the co-op, the one that everybody knows as the co-op, which is basically most co-ops are based around the speed of a horse. How quickly does it take to get a message from A to B? How do you have to set up people in charge of certain areas of things because you can't ask your members very quickly what their opinion is on certain things? Now, that's changed a lot. We've got the internet, we've got email. It's very easy for us to quickly poll our membership to find out what members think. So that, whereas that used to be to a certain extent, a disadvantage for a cooperative. A lot of cooperatives still work this way, where they only ask you once a year at the AGM what you think. I'm not talking about that kind of cooperative. I'm talking about a cooperative where we can send a mail out at a moment's notice to our members and say, you know, we've got this question. What do you think we should do? It's happened before, it will happen again. There are 337 community shops trading in the UK. Redruth could be one of those. So I just want to very quickly talk about what a community share issue is and what the potentials are there. It's not like a normal share. It's not like the ones, if you've ever owned shares in a limited company, or if you've heard about shares. It's not quite the same thing. It's set at a price that anyone in the community can afford. So it could be like £30, could be £10, you know, but the idea is to encourage people to be invested in the future of this venture. You can't sell them. You can only sell them back to the cooperative, and you can only sell them at whatever you paid for them. So that's very important. That prevents people from being able to take control of the cooperative and by purchasing huge volumes of shares and then turning it into a limited company because they've got the most shares or whatever. So you can only sell them back to the cooperative for what you paid for them. However, they can pay you a dividend. If the business is in profit and it's making profits, and we would, you know, definitely want all the workers to be involved in this as well, because they're the ones that are going to be the most incentivized to be able to kind of make this business succeed. The aim would be for them to own shares and receive dividends back from the shares that they owned. There is a set limit on what dividends can be paid, and this is to kind of prevent the you know, fat cat shareholders that you might think about. And there's a limit to what you can pay out, and the rest of the profit has to be spent either on the existing business, improving the post office that we were to create, or to be reinvested into the community. It can't be spent on anything that the community doesn't benefit from. And obviously, you know, for the workforce, there's the opportunity there for increased wages as well, because you do want staff to give high quality service, otherwise there won't be any profit involved in this. And this is a really important one. It doesn't matter how many shares you own, you get one vote. So you might say, well, what's the incentive to buy more shares? The incentive is monetary, because you get dividends based on how much you put in. So if the post office is in profit, then the money would end up going back to the shareholders, to the community in that sense. And the aim with the shareholding in a community cooperative is to have as many people as possible involved. And it's certainly possible. There are shops, pubs and things like that have been purchased, the buildings have been purchased outright. It's you know, quite common to get hundreds of thousands of pounds worth of funding this way, so it does work. Because I've been investigating all of this, because of the recent announcement from the post office, I've been in touch with the Plunkett Foundation, who have agreed that they would help us. They've got hundreds and hundreds of community shops which they've opened up, and community post offices there as well. So there are quite a lot of businesses out there that work very well this way. This is a really interesting number here. So this is in compared to the Co-op, Sainsbury's, Tesco and Morrison's. Community shops from the Plunkett, this information is coming from the Plunkett Foundation, and this is 2014, it's based on 2014. They made a growth of 5.3% year on year. Compare that to Tesco or Morrison's that were making a loss year on year in that period. You can see that community shops really are, financially a better way to do business as well. Sorry, the focus isn't very good on that. Let me just tweet that so you can see. The Southwest got a huge number of community shops. So it's a very popular thing. And it's unsurprising, really, when you think of some of our coastal villages. They you know, need the community to come together to serve them with high quality shop, which improves tourism. And again, that could be something that Redruth could think about. So there's some nice statistics there. You can check out. I'm not going to read them all out, but generally they do outperform typical retailers.
Is that because they run with a lot of volunteers?
No, I don't think necessarily. There are lots of people that do use volunteers, and obviously it's, if you're a shareholder, it's in your interest to do a bit of work here and there to keep the shop open. I think it's mostly to do with the a concept they call, like, the wisdom of crowds, but that in certain circumstances a body of people can make better decisions than a panel of experts. So when you're polling, if you're a shop holder and you're like, what do I stock? I have no idea. What does the community want? You can get up-to-the-minute information about what your community actually wants you to do, and that gives you a huge competitive advantage. Not to mention your workforce normally own shares in the company, and so they are incentivised for the cooperative to do well, because they are essentially, if they get a bit of extra money every 3 months if the co-op does well. And co-ops generally as well actually have higher wages, because obviously if you're in a limited company and you're trying to be competitive, you're always trying to reduce wages and increase profits, at cooperatives, because a lot of the members are also the workforce, the employees. They, you know, if there are profits, then a reasonable share of that profits ends up going to the workforce, as opposed to fat cats, pockets, investors or something. So I'm just going to get this done really, really quickly. I'm going to zip through this. Case studies. It does work a lot. It works very regularly in all sorts of different places around the country. This is one that the Plunkett Foundation sent to me, which is a community shop and also a post office. So that's nice. They're a high quality retailer. I think in Redruth, there are loads of different things that we could sell. The most important thing would be that the shop was profitable in order to support the post office services, and that it was mainly there to as a post office facility. So flicking through that, you know, I've been thinking about this a lot, and obviously I've tried to spread this idea out there as much as possible. Personally, I don't know why you wouldn't do this, because it has a good chance of success. I heard a laugh over there, so we'll come in there with the.
Well, yeah, some nice ideas, but it's very theoretical.
It does work all over the country and quite a lot in the southwest, though, so it's not really theoretical.
It's very theoretical. And but back to the post office here, although, I mean, I only go in there at Christmas and I expect a queue then, and I don't blame or criticise the post office for that.
So why do you say you get atrocious service then?
Let me finish. when my colleagues go up there, they always have to wait, but they don't have to wait so long that it's a problem. And that's with, they've got six counters. But do you ever have six counters in use even at Christmas? I'm not sure that you do. So I'm just wondering how much the post office's problem in Redruth is because its premises are just wrong. What happens upstairs? Does it need upstairs? Is it empty space, or is it used by Royal Mail, or what? That may be a factor in their thinking. I don't know. If the premises are just obsolete, because we do use post offices less now.
No, I don't think so. I think that the current post office is fit for purpose, because of busy periods, you need that space, and Christmas is a case, is an example.
They haven't ruled out as using that existing premises as well.
No,
they haven't.
Coming back to Royal Mail and the point that was raised earlier, I mean, you hear rumours all the time, I heard them today, about what Royal Mail may or may not do. As a private company, they are looking at every single property they've got, and every single delivery office that they have in a centre of a town or a city is under scrutiny. And they are looking to maximise their profits, as you would expect. But I don't think there's any imminent plans, and there is enormous capacity, which could be a reason why they would actually come out, is because they have got plenty of space. In fact, they're rattling around in there. But you can only make it, as you've said, you can only make a decision based on the facts in front of you at any given time.
I don't think it's up to us to prop up their business model. Personally, I think, and it's nothing to do with the workers or anybody that's been involved in the workforce, but I think they've made a number of mistakes over the years that have led them to this downturn. The guy on the phone, it's quite unusual when you're talking to a PR person, he says, yeah, nobody's really coming to the post offices anymore, and this is a PR person, do you know what I mean? Yeah, nobody really wants them.
Can I just say, I've lived in Redruth for 15 years, and I must say there's only three or four occasions I can remember that I haven't had to queue in Redruth. It's one of the most used businesses that I know in Redruth.
So it's a huge opportunity.
And I've always found service lovely in there. Over the years, and that people are interested in you, a little chat. That annoys some people, because the people talk to you for a couple of minutes, say, oh, send this somewhere nice or something like that. But it's what makes it the local community post office.
Yeah.
It is one of the most used businesses that I've seen in this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
This is
one of the gentlemen from the CWU. How much of the building do post office counters occupy? Is it just that front bit that we all see?
Well, there's some office space in behind.
On the ground floor.
Yeah.
And second question,
when these franchises are given birth or whatever else happens, what happens to the existing staff?
They are given a package, which I have to say in current climate is a generous package, which we negotiated, which is only right. You know, you're forcing them out of their current jobs. The alternative for them is that they call it to be across to a new business, which is extremely precarious, should I say, because you might be on the same terms and conditions for about 6 months and then suddenly they get altered. So invariably they will take the package, so they would almost all certainly go. Although there's a member of staff in there who's only been there 4 or 5 months and they will get let go.
So how does the transition work if these people take a package on presumably redundancy, termination of contract? The franchise can't afford to stay closed for 2 weeks, 3 weeks while people are being drained.
No.
So how does the transition work?
Yeah, typically what happens when a Crown Post Office is sold to a franchise, the staff will be offered a package. They invariably take the package if they can't get transferred to another office or somewhere else. They take the package and then some of them may go to the new franchise, but they'll be on minimum wage. And typically they last about 3 months because they do that and they think, blow this. You know, even though they've got a nice wad of money in the bank, it's the way the business is run, the way they're not getting trained anymore, the kind of service that they're giving, and they just think, this is not what I know, and they leave. And we find that in WH Smiths as well. But they will have a staff ready to go on day one of the transfer. So when you shut the doors in one place and you open them, there will be staff.
Where are they from and who would pay them?
Typically, they are minimum wage. Typically, they are very young. And typically, they don't stick around for very long.
And typically, they make lots of mistakes that cost you lots of money.
I think it would be silly
I don't know how many people appreciate just how much is involved in running a post office. The cost financially, if you make a mistake, any loss is down to you. It can be £10, it can be £1,000, it can be more. And you would have to put that right on the night of the balance. So that is a big responsibility. So if you've not got the right staff, or God forbid, as a friend of mine who took over one of these offices to her cost, found they got a pilfering member of staff when they were finally about £6,500 down. The responsibilities are enormous. It's not just stand and chat and sell. You know, the costs involved and the expertise that these people have that the new staff don't get the chance to learn. It used to be a 6-week training course to be a post office clerk. Now it's virtually overnight. Oh yeah, you do this, you do that, and you're away.
I mean, this is surely why those existing staff, if this ends up in a franchise, would be the staff that you would want to employ. You wouldn't want to train someone from scratch.
But you wouldn't be able to match their wages because they're on a very good pay for where we are. I'm not saying that's wrong. I
can't possibly say that.
Yeah, I can, because I was one of those staff.
Yeah.
It's a very good rate of pay for living in Cornwall. I'm not ashamed to say that. That's why people that are working in the post office in Cornwall have got 30 and 35 years service in, because they won't find jobs that match that pay anywhere else. But, you know, you then take them out of that, and as Chris said, they'll take the package because the packages are good. I took a package. You know, the packages are good. They go back to work in the sub-network or the franchise network on, as Chris says, the minimum wage, expected to do the same job. How many of us would do that for any length of time?
Do you think they would do it for a business they owned?
I'm not sure that they would on this model, because, you know, I don't see, unless you've got something sitting alongside it that's got a really good offer, I don't see there being a lot of dividends.
There is, of course, the worker cooperative, which is another model. The only problem is raising the finance. And in my opinion, I think you'd struggle if you did do a worker takeover and form some sort of worker-run business. I think you'd struggle to find the finance in order to do it.
My brother chaired a group of people in his village in South Worcestershire. Mm-hmm. But when the village shop closed, and it was in a village in quite a wealthy area of the country, and they raised a lot of money through lottery funding and all sorts to gain premises, the parish council gave them a site to put the first unit on. It's incredibly successful, and they do have a post office counter in there. However, it's largely manned by volunteers.
Yeah.
There are paid staff, but when you think of sick cover, maternity cover, keeping it going for all the hours that you want it to be open, the owner of that business will let his own business go if it's in a... I mean, I'm an employer,
yeah.
And believe me, there are
I think nobody
issues to employment that we shouldn't
yeah.
underestimate. If the lease for the old building is a full repairing lease, that looks a pretty crappy building to me.
Yeah.
It may be there's massive problems. How long would the lease be? I think there's huge risk unless we went to a different building
yes.
that you could get proper surveys done on.
Sorry. I just think that, if I've not made it clear, I definitely think that, you know, there is risk involved in this. There is risk in it. And that's why nobody's coming forward, apart from people that can... You know, can see that they're going to make a lot of money from having the footfall in their shop.
Can I just ask
there is risk, and I think that one of the reasons that you know I brought this up and is because by sharing this risk between the whole community, you know, then if it doesn't work, which it could happen, you know, the losses aren't really that bad.
But you've got to quantify the risk, because if you take on a lease of a building, that lease will carry on unless you can sublet it if it folds.
Yes, as the cooperative, if it did fold, then the members wouldn't have any liability.
Can I just ask you, Chris, this franchising, and then once they appear on a list, if there's not a preferred partner in a town such as Redruth, are there any out there at the moment that have been sitting on the list for a year, 2 years, three
yes.
years?
Yeah. There was a
state opening.
Yeah, a case. Thinking of a post office that I was involved with was Port Talbot in South Wales. It was previously on the franchise list about 4 years ago. We had a campaign. There was interest in it. We saw them off through the campaign, and it came off the list, and then it was put back on the list, and it's still there. And last January, there was an announcement of 20 crowns, and 10 of them, still no interest in them. It was only where you had W.H. Smith's is the one retail partner where when they say they're taking it, they take it. And all the rest, the general manager for the Crown Post Offices did a conference call where he got all the managers from the Crown Pope, the 37 that have been nominated just of late, and he told them it could take 18 months to 2 years to find an appropriate retail partner.
It does, their process is 18 months to 2 years. It's
well,
the start of a process at the moment.
So why is the closing date so soon?
It's the closing date is for expressing our interest. Yeah.
So can I
still
ask?
Very soon, isn't it?
Sorry, but just say if nobody expresses an interest, it has to stay as a Crown Post Office,
yeah.
Is that right?
My understanding is that after the 28-day period, if nobody has expressed an interest or they feel that whoever it is that has expressed an interest is not suitable, they are saying they will then advertise it again to see whether they can get somebody else. That's what I've been led to believe.
I don't quite understand the 28 days. I think it is just a put it out there and see what we get back in 28 days. But let's be clear, there's a for sale sign above that Crown Post Office now for however long it needs to take.
What actually is the business plan of the post office?
I wish you could tell me.
Oh,
honestly.
Right,
managed decline.
And sorry, what's the other thing? What is the current relationship they're no longer one organisation between it and the Royal Mail, because if I buy a stamp in there, there's a letterbox there somewhere.
Competitive.
There's an inter-business agreement.
Competitive.
Yes.
There's an inter-business agreement between the Post Office and Royal Mail, which is a 10-year agreement. So from the point where they privatised,
where Royal Mail are committed to doing their business, continue to do their business through the post office. I think there's only got about 4 years left to run.
There can't be much left.
No. Not only that, they've also got a penalty clause where they can actually pay a penalty and bail out of it if they so wish. Nobody knows what a privatised Royal Mail may do. I mean, they could walk away from the post office. So what happens to the post office then? It won't exist. It will just go
down the hole. But it's the Royal Mail, you said, owns the building.
Royal Mail owned the building, yeah. The relationship between Royal Mail and the post office right now, I would describe as toxic. You know, they hate each other. Mm-hmm. Considering they were not so long ago one company, they despise each other, and it's
difficult. They're both businesses out. They need to make a profit. Examples: Royal Mail, post office cultivate customers, yeah. Special deliveries. Then as soon as we send off a dispatch that's got 10 or 15 regularly on an evening, they get a direct contact from Royal Mail. Let us come and pick your mail up. So that's cut the post office out of that business. They sell stamps to Superdrug, 5% discount. The post office can't get a discount on their stamps. You know, it's difficult. It's a difficult world out there.
This is why individuals that take over these post offices have so much, so many issues. I mean, I think that with in this community, we have so much knowledge and so many skills. We've got at least one postmaster and one member that's come forward as having been part of the general area. We've got people that are builders, we've got people that are computer scientists, we've got people that do all sorts of different things, and that's why I think if we work together we can be more competitive. And I don't think that we should prop up Royal Mail's business. I think that we should provide a good quality service, and then if the post office ends up disappearing, we continue to provide a similar good quality services to the community. As you say, they're in a slow decline, and I don't think that we should just use community money to spend to keep them propped up. But I think that we should, keep the services for people that need it in the town. Would now be a good time to bring it to? Sorry, just one more thing.
Well, in that case, it seems to be the best thing to do is to say is to try and dissuade anybody from taking the franchise on, yeah. Really, as you were saying earlier, because you stress the risks to it, you say to anybody, I suppose you can't really say we won't shop with you if you have the franchise, but by stressing the risk, it doesn't seem to me that it's a workable business model unless you're using volunteers otherwise. I can't see how we can make we were to set up as a community business, I don't think we could make it pay.
It's a bit of a risky move, isn't it? Just to assume that they're not going to accept the offer that they've had.
As a franchise from a Crown, I'm not quite sure how that works, but would they retain all the services they do now, depending on where they go?
They make a big play that they would, yes. But can I say, on your proposition, what do you want in Redruth? Now, I'm suggesting you want a Crown post office with dedicated staff that provide the best service that you're ever going to get from a post office. And also with the space so that, particularly the elderly, because they do still go to the post office to meet, to socialise. It's sometimes the only contact that they have.
Yeah.
Your proposition, quite frankly, is no different to a franchise. Mm-hmm. Now, it might be owned by the people, but it's still not the post office that Redruth should have.
It's not a Crown.
It's
and
still
I would say
a franchise post office in the back of another
be a
business.
A Crown post office. I would prefer this is a plan B, because as from everybody that I've spoken to, it has been they've made up their mind. They'll put up with a little corner shop. One, they're even talking about splitting up the franchise and putting two kiosks in two corner shops.
But part of me thinks that it's that attitude that lets them do it.
Yeah.
If people didn't go, they've already made up their mind. It might be my Irish background, but if more people in this country protested at what they see as being wrong and raise petitions, in Ireland they try to get water rates brought in the last year. The Irish people said, no, we already pay enough taxes, we're not paying the water rates. They tried to bring a few people to court, everybody objected, the water rates are gone. They're not going to do water rates. And in this country, not enough people protest vehemently enough about what they believe is right.
I think the biggest problem is falling footfall. As for any business, the biggest problem we have is falling footfall, because people will go wherever it's cheapest on the whole. I have people come to the counter now, and a standard parcel, second class, is £2.85. Mm. I say, I can get it cheaper if I take it into Main's garage, cheaper. Or I can
get someone to come to your house and take it off you sometimes.
And that's a big problem, you know.
Can we bring it, before people start disappearing, can we bring it to a vote? I think it would be sensible to do a vote first for action against the closure. So do we want to take action against the current closure, and then maybe a vote to whether we want to take this cooperative idea further. I forgot to mention earlier, we do have St Reuben's on board with it.
So are you suggesting with the voting, that voting to keep the status quo doesn't preclude you from voting for Plan B as well?
I would say so, yeah. I think the first one would be a vote for action, and probably followed by some people that are willing to help spearhead that as well, some volunteers. And then the second one would be a vote for do we want to provide an alternative. But the thing is, if we do provide an alternative, it has to be within 5 days.
There are multiple businesses in Redruth who have spoken to the post office this week, who have expressed interest in taking on counters within their businesses. So it's not just one. I know one is actually meeting with the post office next week. They've gotten approvals pretty much all along the way up until today. So they'll be meeting with the post office next week to actually see if they can finalize it.
That's the one that I know about.
Because the post office is very eager to do this. Mm-hmm. The second business that I know of has spoken to the post office, and they said, let's speak to the first one. If this one doesn't go through, we've already partnered with this business before, and we will speak to you next week as well. So what happens if they decide they're going to pull the sorting portion of the post office out, relocate that? That leaves a massive building sitting there. None of us can afford to take on that building. Nobody can. It will be an absolutely enormous cost. I agree we can come together and try to prevent that from happening as a community, come together, pull together, and say, you know what, we don't want you doing this. We want this post office here in our community because it is a service. Mm-hmm. And I got, like Sinead says, there's a lot of people that go up. We go up there every single day. Mm-hmm. We go up every single day to that post office, and it's, sometimes I'm impatient, and yes, there's people staying up saying, come on, but you stand in the queue and you wait. So it's a well-used post office, I must say. Mm-hmm. I have to agree with that. But if the post office itself is, a Royal Mail actually, is determined to get rid of that building and dump it, one way or another they're going to do it. Mm-hmm. And that's the environment that this current government and everything else is going through. We can protest. We can't say, you know, we don't want this to happen. We want our post office back, and it has worked in other places. It depends on how strong that protest is. And I'm not going to say that it's going to be like the thing they had in London and all over the world against somebody else. But if this community comes together and we say, we want our post office, maybe they'll listen to us.
Are we saying that it should be something in a dedicated premises somewhere that isn't, because I support the idea, because I think if you find one that's in a shop that's not really big enough for it, whoever's running or owning that shop loses customers.
Sure, they do.
That's what we're suggesting.
Because
is
it becomes put people off going in.
Right, it becomes a hindrance, especially for somebody who I'm not that old, but somebody who can't move well, or they need assistance in moving, or they've got a wheelchair or something else, it's difficult to maneuver around aisles and everything else to get into wherever it is they got to go. The other most important thing, I think, that we should be looking at the people who work in this post office live in this community. Those are jobs. Those are families. Those are livelihoods. And we don't want to put people out of a job. We really don't. And if it comes to putting it into a small shop or somewhere else, we're not going to take on the staff. It would be too expensive.
But from what you've said, we're not going to get that opportunity anyway, because they're not going to chew you across. They've got a package.
They've got to think for themselves and say, what's better for me? Am I going to go work over here where the working conditions are not going to be the same? I'm not part of the union. I can't join the union now. So there's a lot of different aspects that we have to look at. And yes, I think that protesting is a good thing. It's a democratic thing. And we have every right to do that. But it's how do you bend their arm a little bit to say, hold on a minute. And you're right, there's nothing like walking into the town and seeing that big sign there that says post office, yeah. Royal Mail, or whoever else is going to be there.
Sorry?
I don't think we have anything like enough information to make any sort of
they
decision.
They won't give us enough information to make a decision.
I think it sounds to me as though the post office is a business model which has had its day. We don't know enough about it, but if all these post offices, these crown post offices are failing and franchises are failing, then there's something wrong with the actual model, which we would be very rash to get involved in. And there's something to suggest that somebody in private business couldn't run it well is, to my mind, absurd. I mean, I'm sure that if I took it on, I could run it well. Just because I'm a private businessman doesn't mean I couldn't run it well. So there's nothing virtuous about it being a crown post office, as far as I'm concerned. But there must be something unfair in the contract between the post office and the franchisees, or something very incompetent in the selection of the franchisees. If the actual terms of the franchise make it impossible to run the franchise well and profitably, and it's got to be both. It's no good just doing it profitably and doing it badly. It's got to be providing the good service, but there's got to be a profit for the franchisee. It sounds to me as though that situation doesn't exist, and so I'd say keep well away from it.
Can I just respond very briefly? I don't believe, because I saw figures on the business providing me with figures, but they wouldn't give me them hard copy. It had to be on a slideshow, and they didn't go up there for long. I do not believe Redruth is loss making. It's not because they're loss making necessarily, it's because it can be done cheaper elsewhere. Mm-hmm. Now, a word of warning to any potential franchisee, you do not make money from the post office. Mm-hmm. Because the terms of the post office are very, very stringent. You know, they are tight. You see lots of sub-postmasters going out of business and handing over the keys because they just can't make it work. It isn't about the post office, it's about their primary business. It's about dragging people in through the door. Mm. So you talk about running a successful post office, that is complete immaterial. It's not about running a good service that is the post office, it's about dragging people into your primary business.
But if Crown post offices can run profitably, which some of them do from what you say, I don't see why I couldn't run it profitably. Unless the terms of the franchise are just unacceptable, why people are accepting them if they cannot do it sensibly.
Well, I think it's that they can make so much extra money for the footfall through the door on sales of Mars bars.
Except you've been arguing that they don't.
I think that the businesses can be very profitable with a post office in the back because of all the people coming through the business in order to use the post office. So like, oh, I desperately need a drink, I need a packet of crisps, I need this.
But if you, I mean, I don't know if you can tell me whether the one in Morton Hampstead on Dartmoor is a Crown post office, I don't know, but it
no,
doesn't.
It's not.
Okay, but that's a small shop with two counters and it sells things like wrapping paper and cards and whatever. And I've no idea what their figures are, and it's a nice little facility, but it's...
How many post offices are there in the UK?
11,500.
And how many are Crown Post Offices?
Just under 300.
I'm really sorry, but I'm running a staff meeting. Can we
know your votes?
Night, Mary.
Well, if depending on what the risk was, yep. I'd probably be willing to buy a share,
yep.
but I'm not willing to get involved or take liability on it.
There is no liability apart from what
And that would be purely and simply if there was no other alternative.
Yeah.
And I don't think the current building is the right one. Really sorry, I'm
Are you voting for action?
Staff coming up.
For letting them know... for taking action against its current closure.
And I would also just add what you said about the risk, because some people went to prison on the basis of not yep. making the books balance because of
Oh, they're taking them to court.
And it turned out to be, I seem to have some
computer glitch. That's what co-operative
detectors It was a computer horizon. Glitch. At, yeah, yeah, it was.
Yeah.
But whether they've sorted that, I don't know, but I think the risk is huge.
No, I'd say.
Anyway, it sorry is. About that.
Yeah. Right, Mary, thank you.
I've got to go as well, Rob. My vote is for protest, petition and protest.
Yeah.
Because I think if people who would be interested in a franchise knew that the people of Redruth were against it being franchised and thought that it would risk a downturn in their own business
yep.
if they took it as a franchise, mm-hmm. I think that wouldn't go ahead. If there was no other alternative, then I'd go with the cooperative one.
I think the biggest issue is that if we do one and not the other, then we will potentially, there is a high risk of it will end up going into a retail. We won't have any say in the matter.
My thing is, I don't think you're going to get, mm-hmm. and I don't think there's enough time between now and when you have to express your interest.
There's 18 months.
Actually, no, I thought you said 6th of February.
So we've got to express our interest by then. We don't have to put a business plan together or to get the money from anyone.
Ah.
We've got 2 years.
Okay.
18 months at the shortest.
Yep. First instinct is to protest. Like I said, it might be me being Irish.
Is anyone volunteering to help organise that, by the way? Any volunteers to help organise any protest or...?
Well, obviously I'd help with any social media or whatever.
Yeah.
In that angry? Way, but I don't have the time to stand outside and pick it.
No.
I'm sorry.
I can't do it.
Thank you for that. Should we bring it to a vote then? And then
wrong door, one mate.
I'm going.
Before you
other door.
When you talk about protest, I think mm-hmm. I understand what the word means, and I think you have to manage people's perception of protest.
I think what we definitely need is some management on that front.
And I'm not volunteering either. but it strikes me that there's sort of four strings to that. And that might well include a letter from Redruth Town Council objecting for valid reasons. The same with the Chamber of Commerce, as the representative of the business. And then somehow to organise a petition, both business and public. And a fourth strand, if you like, would be to identify the risks associated with such a franchise. Mm-hmm. Which is where I think you come in.
Yeah, indeed. There's a number of things you can do. You can get the MP on board, have a public meeting. I think a public meeting is essential, and people will or won't show up to it, and take it from there. And you've got to look, there were some places, like Penzance, they had a great campaign down there. Unfortunately, they were up against W.S. Smith's. You go to St. Austell, who were also up against W.S. Smith's, they didn't have any kind of campaign. The public weren't interested in St. Austell. It's all about the community. Do you want it or not? You know, it really is down to the community. And I think the first port of call is a public meeting. Are we up for a fight? I have to say, I don't think you can have a foot in both camps where you talk about your cooperative, because you could be the franchise, there could be no other franchise.
They both have to happen at the same time, like you say, because if we go out there now and say to the post office, we don't want you to close, and don't put in a bid, then they've already got bids. They could just accept one of the ones they've got. If we do put in a bid, then we're covering both bases. We don't have to agree to anything. We don't have to say we're definitely going to do it. All we need to do is express interest. So, should we bring it to a vote? Anyone that would like to take protest action of any sort, or or petitions to save the post office. That's not unanimous, is it?
No,
it's
not.
I said yes.
Yeah, you did.
It's got one, it's not.
Okay. Anyone that would like to continue to put in a bid as community cooperative?
Good question.
Okay, so is there anybody, it's quite unanimous what we want to do, is there anybody that would organise this?
I did not vote for that.
Nobody that wants to do to organise this, those protest actions?
I'll do it.
Petitions, anything that needs to be done.
Petitions in the melting pot as well.
I'll get the ball.
Can I suggest that you take contact details for the people that are in the room?
Can I say that I do lead on campaigns, but I am too remote, you know, I'm 2 hours up the road.
That's understandable.
However, I will give assistance and my headquarters can provide all sorts of literature and leaflets and posters and we'll have a CWU logo on, I have to say, but
we'll also, we are recording this because there's a lot of people that couldn't make it this evening, so if anybody who is watching this on the camera wants to send in their votes just to top it up, but yeah, that's pretty unanimous for not doing any kind of bid for the post office, and to do a some sort of protest. So Annalie's going to organise that.
Yep. If anyone wants to give me their email address, then I will leave this here for you to come up and write your email. If you don't have it.
Can I ask what's been the Campbell one? The same
position.
Can I ask,
who are your main categories of customer, because if it's older people getting their pensions as it used to be, and perhaps isn't so often now, then you know organisations like Age Concern would be interested. But you know, what is the main business? Or the typical customer?
It is males. Anybody that's got males, but also
the businesses.
Yeah.
More than.
But also, well, the glory there's a lot of private individuals such as, you know, they might have 20, they work from home maybe, got their own little cottage industry going and, you know, 25 parcels a day they send. but predominantly, if you're looking at a particular kind of demography, certainly elderly people are still very much used the post office.
So it's elderly people and business people, is that correct? Okay.
Yeah.
So that's what we need to refer to.
Right. Travel, they do. Travel's important, travel money, and travel services, passport services, they're the one-stop shop for passport services. They do insurance services. There is a wide offering, it's just getting that offer out to people. You'll be amazed how many people still don't know about the cash offering at the post office, that there's part of the bank.
What cash offering?
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. You if you bank with any of the big banks, you can go and get cash free of charge from your account at the post office up to your daily limit. You can pay in cash, you can pay in cheques.
Really? Mm.
Exactly. I'll rest my case.
That's why HSBC closing's got so much, you know.
You will still be able to do your personal banking, not business banking.
Okay. There's a few post offices that closed down in London, and they would say they were franchised, like you mentioned, and they say, sorry, can't do it, you have to go to a big post office and you'd have to travel a long way because the little one didn't do it.
Yeah.
Didn't do what?
All
passports.
Yeah,
they're mostly
disruption.
Not every post office is allowed to offer every service. Most post offices can't offer car tax as it was or as it is, passports, small offices like the one I work in can't sell travel insurance. You can only do, if you've gone out and put it out there yourself, you can sell euros, but you can't sell any other currency out of stock. You have to pre-order it for the customer. So there is a great difference in what can be offered in a Crown branch to what can be offered in a great many other branches.
But is the post office privately owned?
It's a private company.
It's a PLC.
So they're driven by profit, as is every other business.
They have to make a profit, I would imagine. I don't know. Just be on
your own. No, what I'm saying is, the more they quote,
can I ask a gentleman who sit up you again? Are there any sort of national organisations behind your campaign, such as the Aged or whatever?
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
Are there anybody? Yeah. Organisations. Pledging their support to this fight.
Who you would expect? Institute of the Blind, Edge Concern.
Well, that's the sort of thing I think the information we need, and the evidence perhaps, because I don't know, what did the town council decide?
About the post office.
It was discussed, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think it was the usual write a letter of.
Opposition,
but the letter would be better penned with some evidence in it. So, I mean, I hadn't thought about blind people for a start. I mean, not very inclusive, is it? it's not just about the elderly, it's about the infirm and disabled and all of those as well.
But then every business.
The point I'm trying to get at is if people are approaching you, then that's information that you ought to be sharing with us.
I tell you, another organisation is the Women's Institute, who are very always very supportive.
We don't have one in Redruth.
You do.
You do.
The town's Women's Guild, but not all.
No, we do have one. Right, it's based in Lanner, but it's the Redruth. Yeah. It is the Redruth WI.
Four
lines have got WI. There's branches all over the county. Truro's got the office of WI.
The one in Lanner is called the Redruth WI.
Which is funny, don't have it in Lanner.
Well, I knew it wasn't in Redruth.
There'll be people from Redruth.
So I think it's really valuable. Thanks everyone for turning up today. If we hadn't